Okay, hello and welcome to this first session. Thanks a lot for joining me today. This is a workshop that is designed to help equip you with some tools to organize your research projects, whether they're about Ann Lister or in the wider field of Ann Lister related studies. It is pitched at a fairly beginner level, so it's most suited to those people who maybe haven't studied history before, in a formal way or a related subject. And it's also for anyone who may have studied history but might find their skills are a little bit rusty. Essentially, it's for anyone who just needs a little bit of inspiration to get your thoughts together and who wants to know what they should do to go about sharing them with other people as well. It's a workshop. I've tried to make it as interactive as I can. However, the online format does limit things a little bit. We also don't have loads of time, so you may be slightly limited on that. I also do want this to be useful for people who are watching it afterwards on YouTube. So instead of kind of a lot of interaction during the session, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you actions, and I'm requesting those of you at various points. And to get the most from the session, try to note those down as we go through and commit to revisiting them after this session and potentially after this weekend. For those of you who don't know me, I work at a university in Cambridge. I lead a course in the arts, humanities and social sciences, and I completed a PhD in literature at Oxford. I've worked in research-oriented universities for several years, and much of my professional work has been in something called research communications, which is about engaging the media and the wider public with what happens in universities. I've also done a lot of outreach work with schools as well, and that's kind of what I'm bringing to the session today. Before we begin, a caveat though, what I'm covering is very much based on my experiences as a researcher and a communicator. It stems also from the conversations I've had with people who are doing research in the Ann Lister world, many of whom are amateur researchers, and some of the challenges that they have faced when approaching this. However, this is not a workshop that will necessarily translate for everyone and everyone's ways of working. Also, if you are doing a course at school or university, make sure that you follow the guidance of your tutors, so you can't blame me if you don't get the grade that you want. So, to kick us off, I thought we'd start with two definitions of research. It's in the title of this event, the Ann Lister Research Summit, but what does it really mean? The first definition, I found this one online, it talks about research being the creation of new knowledge or the use of existing knowledge in a new and creative way to generate new concepts or understandings. And I actually really like this definition because I like the idea that research is not something that's kind of stale and boring, it's something that's new and exciting and creative. And those are the feelings that lots of people have had when they're coming across Ann Lister. They're finding that there's things that are exciting and that make them want to be creative in no matter what format that is. The other part I like about this definition is new concepts or understandings. You only really have an impact with them if you share them with other people. So that's kind of a focus of the later part of this session. The second definition, I don't like quite so much, if I'm honest. Research is an organized and systematic investigation into something. Now, I can see why this is important, but I personally am not very organized or systematic about anything, really. So this is something that I have to work at. But I thought it was a helpful way of thinking about it because it's the flip side of the newness and creativity. That only succeeds if you can also be a little bit organized and a little bit systematic. I will say also that, as with all things in life, none of us are perfect, and the most important thing is to have good intentions. It has to be said, especially for those of us who are doing research on a more amateur basis, so we're juggling our kind of interests, it's like a hobby, but it's on top of all the other things in our life, so our work, our families, our other commitments. So I think it's really important to say that this is not a workshop that hopes to make you judge yourself in any way or compare yourself to other people. You should do what works for you. Good intentions are key. Good habits are nice to have, but they are optional. So moving on, I'm going to introduce you to some of the things that are important in being a researcher as a new way of maybe thinking about what you've been doing to date. So this is something called the Cambridge Researcher Development Framework. As you can see, it's a wheel. And within that, it has about 15 different qualities that the University of Cambridge has decided are important for professional researchers for their career development. Obviously, most of us here aren't professional researchers, so this will not be completely relevant. However, there are things that we can learn from within that. I will say, professional or not, everyone has strengths and weaknesses, everyone has preferences and dislikes. And also, for many of us who are coming from different sections of the world, we're bringing different skills and experience from our own personal lives. And some of those are actually transferable. We just may not realize it. So my first action, as I kind of break down that wheel, is for you to note down your strengths and weaknesses, your personal strengths and weaknesses. I want you to kind of recognize the things that you are good at. And I want you also to look at ways that you can develop. What do you bring from the things that you've done before that someone else might not bring? What do you like doing? But also, what do you not really like doing? What are you less confident with? So the first section is personal effectiveness. And this is something that I think can be quite broadly applied to maybe not just your research, maybe your whole life. The first one is time and project management. And you will know what you know is the reality for you. You may not have much time, so you really need to make that work for you. You may have loads of time, but know that deep down you're not very good at directing yourself and making the most of that. So time management is really important. There are tips and tools that you can learn that will help you make the most of the time you have. Something like the Pomodoro method, where you kind of you commit to focus for short blocks at a time, can be really helpful. And the word project management here also seems kind of unusual, because we don't necessarily think of what we're doing as a project that needs managed. We think it's just a project. Some of us may do project management in your careers, but also, even if you don't call it that, if you have done any kind of major life event, like organizing an event or moving house, that uses all the same skills of project management, because you're having to be organized and plan ahead and have different things coming in. So you could apply that here as well. And moving on to information management and ICT skills, it seems probably inevitable nowadays that you will need to use computers at some stage. Are you completely confident with that? Could you learn more about that? Information management, that's the flip side of that. It could also be a computer-based thing. It could be organizing the materials that you have and filing them in a sensible way. But it could also be how you store your handwritten notes or your books or any other materials that you have. If I asked you right now to go and find that really interesting quote that you read last week, last month, could you tell me what it was immediately? And if you couldn't, could you go and find it exactly to the page? If you couldn't, perhaps looking at information management might be helpful for you. Creative thinking and problem solving is maybe a harder thing to kind of pin down in yourself. But if you don't see it in yourself, you probably do see it in your research, because you are being creative whenever you're making connections between different things. And I think it can also apply to how you manage things in your everyday life as well. And finally, for me, I think probably one of the most important things for an amateur researcher is this self-leadership and resilience. It's your ability to direct yourself, your autonomy, and your sticking power. You may know if you're the type of person that can stick with something through the hard times, but you also might know that you're the sort of person who might put things away if it gets a bit tough. So a lot of research is quite independent and is quite lonely. So you need to think of the strategies that you need to keep yourself going through those times. It might be something like planning with smaller milestones that are quite achievable, breaking something down into manageable sections or themes, or perhaps just simply setting yourself deadlines or making commitments like presenting a something like this to give you that thing that you're working towards, and that will then give you something that you can be pointing towards. The next section is research expertise. So this is obviously something that's never done. Even someone who has received a Nobel Prize will admit that their research expertise is an ongoing project. If you have very little historical training, if you don't have a PhD in history or you've never studied history before, you definitely could benefit from looking at some of the methods and techniques. And a really simple way to get started with that would be simply to read some history books or history papers and see how others have done it. What approaches did they take? You can also gain practical skills like those things I talked about, handling information, more on that later. Broader disciplinary knowledge, we know that no subject sits in isolation, and actually none of these skills sit in isolation either. They all work together as part of a whole. So for broader disciplinary knowledge, think, you may be very focused on Ann Lister, but what about the wider context of that time period? What about the wider themes that, that you're interested in? How do they appear across different time periods? Ethical requirements, they don't apply so much when you conveniently study people who died a long time ago. However, there are definitely legal requirements relating to copyright if you're using materials and things like that. And if you want any help with copyright as it relates to this kind of amateur research, check out a presentation that we delivered at last year's Research Summit, available on YouTube. And then also foreign and programming languages. You may think it doesn't apply here. So for example, foreign languages, come to the translating Ann Lister session to see how that might happen. And also simply for for Ann Lister herself, as you'll see in vocabularizing with Ann, that actually some of Ann Lister's own language you may need to brush up on as well. Programming as well, if you are IT minded, I personally think there's so much that you can do in the digital humanities space with all the material we have on Ann Lister. And to date, I have never met anyone with the exact skill set to do that. But if you're interested in it, I would love to see that. And then finally, engaging others. Some of this isn't as relevant to people who aren't doing it as a career. Teaching and supervision, leadership and mentoring are more on the professional side of things. However, writing and presenting with impact and collaborating with others are absolutely vital here. If the thought of writing your own thoughts down scares you, I've got some tips coming up soon. So what are your strengths and weaknesses? If you have been writing some things down here, if you want to share them in the chat, feel free to do so. And actually sharing, seeing other people's strengths and weaknesses may help you to think differently about yourself as well. So if you want to share them, please go ahead and do that in the chat. I'm now going to move on to some tips and tools. The first one is to practice taking notes. I know it sounds ridiculous, but making notes is quite different from taking notes. In making notes, you are engaging critically with it. You're actively making connections, not simply summarizing. I think that's really important. The next thing is to not just throw them on the pile and forget about them. Ensure that you can find those notes again, save them somewhere where you can maybe keyword search them. And I have a tool for that coming up later. Or perhaps you can index and catalog them. I think that's definitely what Ann Lister herself would have done. And I have to say that when I was doing my PhD, I had notebooks full of notes, and each of them did have an index in the front because I am that sort of person, apparently. And it was really helpful when I needed it. Dated, full list, perfect. And then the next one is don't rely on your memory. Even if you have a really good memory, if you read something that completely blew your mind, the truth is domestic emergencies happen, family crises, or just real life gets in the way, and things do, they just disappear out of your head. So make sure that you don't rely on your memory and rely on your notes instead. Record all the details, page numbers, names, web addresses, record everything so that you then have access to it later, so that you don't spend a lot of time having to redo things. And then finally, keep it safe. Nowadays with cloud technology, you could save everything in Google Drive and it will automatically update itself, which is great. In terms of tips and tools, I also want to suggest some kind of actual tools that you can use. So these are some things that are used by professional academics. Most of them are actually free to use in some capacity before you need like a license or something. And they're also fairly simple. If you were to watch, for example, a training video on YouTube, you would probably be able to work it out. So Zotero is a reference managed software, so you can store all your references in there. It will automatically create your bibliographies, and it's so simple to use that undergraduates use it. So I'm sure any of you could manage that. Trello is a project management tool, so that's for tracking your progress, especially helpful if you're working with other people. And you can also check off tasks yourself as well. I used that when I recently moved house to make sure that I didn't forget to reroute the mailman and all of that. And then finally, Evernote, which is basically a digital notebook. So if you were to save your notes in that, you could tag them with certain years or certain themes, and then you could search also within them for keywords. So if you can remember that certain word, you can search within that. So that's a really helpful tool. So my next action that I want to make you do is to pick one of these or one of the tips or something that's a weakness and you want to work on. Pick it and work with it for 1 month. If it doesn't work for you, it's only been a month, you've got the rest of your life ahead of you. Wonderful. If it does work for you, it's the start of a new habit and that will be helpful going forward. So just pick one thing and commit to that today. Finally, if there's something in particular that you're struggling with, there's also lots of help online. Archives have lots of information that they often release for their students and academics. You can use it as well. Finding materials, especially helpful if it's archive specific, managing references, some of those things I can see in the chat, you can find help online for free. I've put two links in here, which you can follow up with after this session when the recording is released. But also, as an action, check what your local university or a university you respect has on their website. What do they list in academic skills sections, is what they're usually called, and make sure you have a read at them. They're free, you might as well. And then finally, moving on to throwing your mind on paper. This is the bit that's about writing. So Anne Lister said it well, it always does me good. So sharing your research in 5 steps. I've tried to keep it as simple as I possibly can. The first step is review what you have. Don't use that as a point to just keep going forever and ever, but use it to look if there are gaps where you need to fill, so maybe gaps in contextual knowledge or something like that. Also use that as a time to go over those notes and sources on your topic. The next thing is to work out just 3 or 4 key things that you absolutely need to say or that you want to share. What can you say that's new or interesting? Thinking back to that definition, those are your key messages. And the idea is that if someone only remembered those and only those, you still succeeded. Then you can think about what's the best way to share it, what's the best format, different topics might have been more appropriate for different formats. Something that comes in a series could work in a blog. Something that's highly visual could work in a video or a slideshow. So think about your preference and your skills and be ambitious as well. And then build back your story. So you've got your key messages and now you're reframing it using your research. Add in the evidence that supports the assertions that you've made. Don't forget about the wider context beyond your detailed focus. So it's easy for us to get stuck in tunnel vision. Make sure you reference your sources fully so that you're contributing to a conversation and not stealing ideas. And then also those little nuggets that you find along the way that you find really stimulating, make sure that you add them back in because other people will find them just as entertaining, whimsical, horrifying as you did. So don't forget to add that back in so that people enjoy it as much as you did. And then finally, edit, share, ask for help, collaborate. Don't just use other people as proofreaders. Ask them, are my points understandable? What if you were arguing against me, what would you say? And use that as a way of moving forward. And also, really important, also other people can be helpful fact checkers as well. So we are getting near to the end. I appreciate that was very quick, but we have 10 minutes now. And in the final bit, I wanted both to be open to questions, but also to have a fun live example of coming up with key messages. It's also an excuse to put a picture of a bonnet in my presentation. So we have resources or sources linked to Anne Lister's clothing. We have the quotes from her journals, bonnets, beaver hats, swords, standard. We also have a book about English women's clothing, so that's our wider context about the time. And then we've also got a blog post from a blog about kind of sexuality and fashion, so that might be an angle that we could take. So my questions for you are, regardless of what you know about this or don't know, in some ways knowing nothing means you can be wildly creative. What questions could these sources answer? What things might people want to know about Anne Lister based on these? What could the combination of them tell us that might be new and different? If you do know a bit about Anne Lister's clothing, maybe you've been transcribing a lot, what key messages might you have based on your current understanding? And what format might be best to communicate research, particularly about fashion? An unusual topic, perhaps. What might be best? So I'm going to hand over to Marlene. I think he's going to take any questions if you want to raise your hand. Or please think on these and pop them in the chat. Feel free to raise your hand. Or we can leave early, whichever you would prefer.
Erin, I see you have your hand raised. Would you like to unmute yourself and ask a question?
Yeah, hey. It's not necessarily quite on topic with the exercise, but I was wondering if you could expand a little bit about like some of your experiences with imposter syndrome, because I know that I sort of process a lot of information and I read a ton and ton and ton, but I never like quite feel comfortable enough like making a statement about like, I'm gonna say something interesting about this. And I wonder if you can expand on some of your personal experiences with that.
Yeah, no, I think it's a really good question. And I think it's something that probably lots of people attending this weekend feel like, what right do I have to be at a research conference? And what right do I have doing this? I have those same feelings. What right do I have to give this presentation? I think everyone has it. Even, you know, I work with students who are attaining absolutely top grades in the UK, they feel it too. They are also, you know, they feel like they can't keep up. So I think it's really important to bear in mind that, you know, research is not something that, you know, you necessarily need to prove yourself in. If you're not a professional, you can do it for fun. You can, just as you can read books for fun. And I think quite often we do get caught up in what other people think about us. And actually, if you're enjoying it, I'm almost certain that you can find someone else that will enjoy what you're doing as well. So absolutely never feel that that's not a good thing to do. I do work in a university, I have a PhD, I feel it too. And I know that it's that way basically for everyone. It's a part of life, and you have to learn in that resilience and self-leadership that sometimes you've just got to do it, because otherwise you'll never know. Anyone else want to chip in? I can see some comments in the chat that are great. I saw lots of people talking about their weaknesses as well. And whenever I said weaknesses, I did say strengths and weaknesses. So remember that you're not meant to go away with this, with the list of your faults. You're also thinking of the things that you're quite good at, especially because you can maybe share them with someone else that maybe doesn't have that same experience. Any other comments or questions? Nope.
Hey, Sarah, your hand is raised. Would you like to unmute yourself?
Hello, yeah, I was just going to respond to the, I guess, the question of like, what questions could these sources answer? I've read the blog post that Eleanor Medhurst wrote, and one of the questions that she brings up is how we understand Gentleman Jack in relation to these texts and sort of what sort of edits have been made to the history for it to be accessible, for Anne Lister as a figure to be recognisable to audiences. And I thought that was really interesting, the fact that she talks about the figure of the top hat. And I think that really interested me when I was sort of starting to look into my research, even sort of like around Halifax, like the fact that the image of the top hat has become so prolific and ubiquitous with Anne Lister. And then sort of sources like this, it's like, well, actually, there's two stories going on here, and it's just so interesting.
I think one of the things that would be really interesting to do this project would be that, yeah, we have the contemporary understanding of clothing and how clothing links to gender, and then actually that does not always map with actually Anne Lister's own experience of clothing and gender and self-expression. I see Jenna in the chat is saying she'd be interested in, yeah, the historical context of lesbian fashion. I do recommend that blog. It's really interesting. And I have also heard there's another researcher who's working on the top hat through time, and how the top hat is kind of like a slightly later Victorian thing for men to show. And the bigger the top hat, the better the man, apparently, or allegedly. I think sometimes people compensate too much. I think that's really helpful. I also see a chat comment from Patricia Book talking about the distinction between historical research and other types of research. The truth is, actually, quite often it's the methods that differ, but the way of thinking doesn't change. I think it's the methods and the disciplinary knowledge that are the real thing. But actually, if you if you've done it in one sphere, you can almost certainly do it in another. And if you can do research on Anne Lister, you can do it on lots of other things too. I think it's often just the technique. So my background's in literature. Give me a poem, I'll be happy for a day, I can tear it apart. And I know that that's how other people feel whenever they find, for example, an Anne Lister journal passage or something. I think I'm probably about to be called on time. So I will finish the session now. It has been a whistle-stop tour. I talk very quickly, so I hope you've kept up. You can find me after on Twitter. If you want to tell me about the actions that you're taking and you want me to hold you accountable, I will do that. Otherwise, I will look forward to seeing you in the sessions over the rest of the weekend. Remember, as Chantelle often said, research is not pie. There's enough for everyone. And I think I will leave on that as my final comment.